it is my distinct privilege and great honor to introduce today Professor Mark Geisbrecht. Mark is the director of the David Sheraton School of Computer Science at the University of Waterloo. And I wrote a few things down here about him. Mark got his PhD at the University of Toronto in computer science, and then did his duties in several places in Manitoba, at the University of Western Ontario, before he joined the University of Waterloo. He's a distinguished scientist of the Association for Computing Machinery, and he has won the Synergy Award for Innovation by NSERC. But I also want to say a few things about his committee work, because we are not so familiar about this in the United States. He served on the Hertzberg Prize Committee, which is the equivalent to our National Medal of Science. This is the highest scientific award that Canada gives, and it's administered by NSERC, as is the National Science Medal by NSF. He also served on the Brockhaus Prize Committee, which is a prize that NSERC gives for interdisciplinary research. He has done much evaluation work. He is on NSERC in a major function. He is the liaison to computer science. He has evaluated several projects of INRIA in France. He has been on hearing panels for the Austrian Science Foundation Fund. And most importantly to us, he has served on many panels of the National Science Foundation. So be nice to him. So, for me, I served on Mark's PhD thesis committee at the University of Toronto, and recently we have started a series of workshops on hybrid methodologies. Hybrid here means both symbolic and numeric in nature. And these workshops so far have happened at Berkeley, at Waterloo, and in Beijing during the ECIAM conference. And the last thing I want to say for us is one of his PhD students, who he recruited successfully away from us, is now a professor at the Naval Academy. So welcome, Mark, and we're looking forward to you.
Thank you. So thank you, Eric. You know a lot. Okay. Today I wanted to talk about something not symbolic numeric, really. And I think it's a talk that it's kind of a little personal, because it's describing sort of connecting two areas of computing that I've been doing, but more connecting them through a mathematical structure that I didn't really know was there, and sort of suggesting there's a lot of similarities or connections between these two, and hopefully suggesting some future directions as to how to proceed, and I'll present some open problems. None of this goes particularly, I mean, it's all fairly accessible, none of it goes particularly deep. So please ask questions whenever you want, and I'd be happy to try to address them. So. I think one of the, many in this room know, random matrix theory, especially over the reals or the complexes, has become a very deep and successful area of interest. Part of this is an idea to carry some of these ideas in, or some of this, to look more thoroughly at random integer matrices. And I guess that wasn't my primary motivation, but it certainly is something that I'm interested in. So suppose somebody gives you a random integer matrix, and I'm not really going to say what that means, and there's various interpretations of this. And the question is, what can you say about it? Of course, we could talk about it as a real matrix. That's sort of the the first year linear algebra approach to this. You can talk about eigenvalues. You can talk about Jordan forms. As an integer matrix, you talk about the lattice, an integer lattice, sort of the integer combinations of the rows and columns. And you talk about things like invariant factors and determinantal divisors and Smith or Smith-McMillan or Jacobson normal forms. I'll define those. And the fundamental, and so these are things where I've been involved in computations, mostly symbolic computations, but of course there's an industry and a large scientific knowledge on doing numerical computations of at least it's a real matrix. And the question that I'd like to talk about here is how are these related? Sort of are these integer matrix algorithms connected to these numerical algorithms? And are they related at all? And more importantly to me, I mean, a computer scientist, what does this say about how to compute them? So, first observation, you give this on your first year linear algebra exam, and of course matrices over the integers are matrices over the reals, matrices over the complexes. And so what do you do? You compute the Jordan form of that matrix, and you magically get a set of eigenvalues down the diagonal. This is the Jordan form. I'm ignoring the fact that there could be ones on the superdiagonal. Generally, there aren't. And the numbers are all real. It's generally, they are not. You know, there's going to be some complex. But nonetheless, the example, the example is, I think, not too, it's good enough for what I'm going to talk about here. So, that's probably partly it. So now, I don't have to explain to this audience what a Jordan canonical form is, but of course, I'll say a little bit for notational purposes. It's a sequence of Jordan blocks, typically does not define the ordering of these blocks. I'll need to talk about the ordering of the blocks later. They can have ones in the diagonal. Generically, there are no ones on the superdiagonal. It gives a very nice description of the invariant subspaces of these matrices. Both whether this is over a discrete field, like the finite field, it's used in combinatorics and counting arguments. Numerically, it's used in all kinds of things. And of course, the eigenvalues are the roots of the characteristic polynomial, which is a monic polynomial over the integers. So again, obvious facts, but we will need these. And I sort of got my start, as I mentioned, I was a PhD student in Toronto, and I sort of got my start in computing this in my PhD thesis, and looking at the complexity of computing the Jordan form. And so the complexity in terms of field operations. So, now, I mean, numerically, Jim Demel, probably 10 years before that, had looked at it as a numerical problem, so not looking at the complexity, but looking at some of the numerical stability issues of the Jordan form, which there are many. I'm not going to pretend otherwise, but I was looking at what is the actual cost? And so the cost here is, there was an algorithm from 1987 by Ludeberg, n to the fourth. So now we're not counting coefficient size in here, I'm simply counting field operations. And what I did in my thesis was get this down to n to the omega, where omega is the cost of doing a matrix multiplication. And in algebraic complexity, this is sort of the base computation, and there's this whole series of results getting it down from n cubed, which is the obvious algorithm, to Strassen in the 60s, getting it down to n to the 2.8 something, and then down to the most recent is at ISAC in 2014 to 2.37286. Remember that number. It actually, I'm going to get close to that number, but not. But we'll see in a second. And so that's the cost of multiplying two matrices together. You will never use that algorithm. The constant is astronomical. So this is astronomical. So this is more of the thing to think about here is reducing computations to matrix multiplication. And then even in practice, this is a good thing because then you can implement things using matrix multiplication, which you can optimize like crazy. So there's a theoretical aspect, but there actually is a practical aspect. And then, of course, this is over a field, so we're counting field operations. We can look at counting bit operations because of integers. Of course, integers grow, and so it matters that we count the cost of these growing integers. And so we want to count bit operations or machine operations. And so there, actually, with remarkable amount of work, with my postdoc time, Arnestor Johan, who's now a professor at Waterloo, we got this down to n to the fourth operations. And we weren't even trying to use fast matrix arithmetic. And so that's far harder than it should be, and there may well be a better way to work do it there, but it actually works quite well in practice. I mentioned demo in 83, and that was actually his PhD thesis. There's, of course, been much work since then on computing Jordan form and things like that in the numerical case. And this is a difficult problem that I'm just going to ignore for the rest of this talk. But I do want to talk about sparse matrices a fair bit, because part of the motivation here is sparse matrices. So by sparse matrices, I guess I mean matrices that are, let's say, mostly zero. So of the n squared entries in a matrix, let's say n log n of them are non-zero. So, you know, almost all of them are zero. And the question is, can we compute more quickly with the sparse matrix? And of course, this is a huge industry, again, in the numerical setting. And it also, because of things like integer factorization and cryptography has become a huge thing, and many other applications has become a big application in computational algebra, as well as in systems like Maple and Mathematica also make use of sparse algorithms for many things in a fundamental way. And so here the question is, how fast can we compute the Jordan form of the matrix when it's sparse? And the answer, at least for the minimal polynomial, which is a good chunk, is a good representation of the eigenvalues, or that if it's an n by n matrix, but it's with mu non-zero entries, so if you think of mu as being n, so n out of n squared, so that's pretty sparse, then the cost is n squared instead of n cubed. So that's a whole factor of n big better than the dense algorithm. Which is, is a huge deal. And this is actually a Lanczos-like algorithm that works over finite fields. It works in a discrete domain. So you think of this as conjugate gradient or Wiedemann's method or Lanczos algorithm taken into this discrete domain, which is a wild thought. I mean, it's hard to imagine how it works. It's a brilliant paper. And now, Jordan form is actually harder. And in 2000, Joe Villard had a lovely result to show that the cost for compute the Jordan form is actually n to the 2.5. So now the minimal polynomial actually is enough in sort of the generic case, but it doesn't capture all the ones on the superdiagonal and things like that, and repeated roots and stuff like that. So the Jordan form is something harder to do, and it's n to the 2.5. As I say, these are Krylov-type algorithms,
Getting exactly the Jordan form?
It's computing a rational Jordan form. It's computing a representation that if you wanted the exact one, you'd have to do root finding on these various pieces. Okay. I want this to work over any field, not just a real field, so the analog is rational. So I left out a word there. Thank you. And the idea here is we're using the matrix A, we don't look inside it at all. We simply use it as a black box. And the black box takes a vector to the matrix times the vector. And so if the matrix is sparse, that operation becomes very fast. So these are not sort of dissection type methods where you're actually looking at a representation of the non-zeros in the matrix and doing some data structure. These are actually, they're essentially all black box methods, where we just treat the matrix as a linear operator. Okay, so open problems. So I have two open problems here. The first is to find an algorithm for computing the Jordan form of a sparse matrix, which requires n to the alpha plus n mu operations, where alpha is strictly less than mu. Alpha is strictly less than omega. So it's faster than matrix multiplication. So this is, n squared would be perfect. We'd love n squared. So can we do this? That's a theoretical question, but there may well be a practical way of doing it. And actually, I gave this talk a couple of weeks ago, I gave a version of this talk. It'll end up being different. Eric said, yeah, but I think Gilles did something. Gilles Villard, the guy who did the previous slide. Oh, there it is. No, it's the previous slide. Anyway, right there. That's Gilles Villard, right there. into the 2.5, he actually did something. And now, do you remember matrix multiplication? N to the 2.37286. In Gilles' habilitation, I sent him an email, and he said, it's N to the 2.36. Just slightly less. And he sends it to me in sort of this embarrassed way that I... But actually, this is brilliant, because what this says to me is that this problem is not somehow fundamentally tied to matrix multiplication. So the worry would be that, of course, matrix, that there's a reduction the other way that says this problem is still harder than matrix multiplication. And the fact that you can don't beat it at all is great, right? It means that there's no fundamental connection to our lower bound from matrix multiplication. I mean, maybe that's the lower bound. It is actually an optimization based on some craziness on being able to multiply rectangular matrices a little faster than square matrices, but it breaks the empty field a bit earlier. So that's cool. I think I like this better. I mean, I would like N squared better, but this is a paper by myself and Wade Eberle and Pascal Georgie and Arnaud Sturiohan and Gilles Villard. It's actually a sequence of two papers. And we can compute the inverse of the sparse matrix in N to the 2.27. Again, counting field operations. And that's actually amazing, right? So that's considerably less. That's a formula in terms of omega, but it's considerably less. And that actually, there's even a practical implementation of this. So this is not completely living in a theoretical la-la land. But so the question then becomes, can we do the Jordan form? And there's a whole series of problems that we would like to get in sub n to the omega cost. But this is the only two I know of. And that one, I actually hadn't realized that Gilles' trick until last week. Okay, what's the average case? So the Jordan form and the average case. I'm not going to spend very much time on this because it's not that exciting, and it's pretty much what you expect for a random integer matrix. And when I say random, I mean part of this is just to introduce what random is. I'm going to set a capital N, and I'm going to choose coefficients randomly from a range between 0 and N, or minus N over 2 and N over 2, or something like that. And I'm going to say the Jordan form is diagonal when the characteristic polynomial is square-free. And at that point, it becomes fairly straightforward if you've seen these proofs before. Basically, it's square free if the discriminant is non-zero. If the discriminant is non-zero, well, turns out that this is these are the coefficients are polynomials in the random entries of the matrix. And if you take the fundamental tool here, and I'm not going to dwell on this, is if you take a non-zero polynomial and you evaluate it at a random point, it's probably not going to be zero. And so that's a tool. There's a, first of all, that makes intuitive sense. There's a very precise sense that this can be said, which is by Schwartz and Zippel in 1979. And so what we're able to prove is the probability of A is diagonalizable is greater than 1 minus 2 times the dimension of the matrix squared divided by N, which says if we choose a large enough range, then this goes to 1, right? So almost all matrices are diagonalizable. As I said, it's not a particularly exciting proof, and I'm going to skip it. And so the idea that a random matrix is probably diagonalizable is certainly well known. When you try it, almost all of them will be. There will be complex numbers on the diagonal if they're real. It's a real matrix, but there's nothing terribly surprising there. Okay, now let's look at integer matrices. So I said you could view this matrix as an integer matrix. You can view it as a real and complex matrix. Let's view it as an integer matrix. And here, integer matrices, it's very important to maintain the lattice structure. We want to do operations which are invertible over the integers. Okay, so that means invertible. An operation is invertible over the integers if it's the determinant is plus or minus 1. You multiply it by another matrix whose determinant is plus or minus 1. So that's called a unimodular matrix. So these are lattice-preserving transformations. So here's so let's try to diagonalize this matrix. Now I'm not going to use similarity transformations here. I'm simply going to, I can multiply on the left, I can multiply on the right, but the matrices that I multiply by have to have determinant plus or minus 1. So if I take their inverse, the inverse is also over the integers. Okay, so what do? You start out with your original matrix. You take a unimodular matrix and you target that entry there, and you introduce a zero there. You do it again, another matrix, you target that entry there, and you introduce a zero there. Okay, so now you've got first column just being the subdiagonal is zeros. And so now let's target the first row. And you've introduced a zero there, but oops, you've got a problem down there, but let's not worry about that. And you introduce a zero there. And now you've got two zeros on this row. But now you've actually introduced a one there. And it's easy enough to use that one to clear the entire first column. So you're done. You've killed off the first column, and you've done this entirely with matrices that I promised you have determinant plus or minus one. So this is completely invertible while staying inside the integers, which is great. And so that's basic operation for the Smith form, because now we can do it again. We just repeat on this, we recurse on this lower triangle, the lower right-hand block. So you do the same thing again, and there is a diagonal matrix. And of course, now if you talk linear algebra 2, you know that every matrix is unimodular equivalent to a matrix in Smith form. And so that gives you an algorithm. In fact, this algorithm was precisely the algorithm of Harold Smith, who introduced this in 1861. And it's not a very good algorithm, but it does work. It's actually exponential. It gives you exponential intermediate expressions well. And if you run at it, also potentially these matrices here can grow exponentially large. So it's a bad algorithm, but it's a constructive algorithm. It gives a constructive proof of this theorem. And the theorem is that every matrix is going to have a diagonal, is going to be unimodularly equivalent to a diagonal matrix, where this divides this, and this divides this. S1 divides S2, S2 divides S3, S3 divides S4, etc. Just as 1 divides 3 divides 9 in the previous example. These SIs are unique up to the sign, plus or minus 1. The SIs are called the invariant factors of the matrix, and Smith essentially had this algorithm in 1861. So probably it's something we know now. And the question is, how fast can we, a bunch of questions now come up, how fast can we compute this? How fast can we compute this when it's sparse? And actually looking at some of the random asymptotics of this is also interesting. So what we show, so we actually looked at computing this form in 2000, and I'll talk a little bit about the computation later, but actually, as a byproduct of wanting to do the analysis, we said, well, what does a random Smith form look like? And you type it into Maple or Mathematica 3 or 4 times, and you always get the same answer. A random Smith form looks like ones. The Smith form of a random matrix looks like a whole pile of ones and the determinant. That turns out to be really hard to prove. It's actually quite painful. And I'll give you an idea why, and it'll sort of play into what comes next. But we were able to show that if the entries are chosen randomly and uniformly from lambda n, which means the number is essentially from 0 through n, then the expected number of non-trivial invariant factors, i.e. the expected number that aren't 1, is about log base n of n. Now, of course, if n is considerably larger, if big N here, which is the size of your set you're drawing from, is considerably larger than the dimension of the matrix, you expect it to be exactly of this form here, trivial. Okay, so it's sort of a, you try it 5 times and you realize, yeah, this is the case. It's got, how do you prove it? It was, as I say, it was surprisingly difficult. This has been picked up, actually not picked up, this has been done, looked at more recently by Wang and Stanley.
What if you allow negative numbers to change anything?
If you allow
negative entries.
Negative entries is fine. In fact, if you look at the way I defined it, it turns out that any contiguous range So you're not allowed to look at even numbers, for example. That would actually mess it up. But you, if you start with k and you go up to k plus capital N for each random entry, everything works fine.
If your random entries are discrete, then
if you were to choose from any, you can. If you had a, they're discrete. But if you can't just say choose from a particular set, and do it, because if you think about it, well, if everything is a multiple of two, for example, it's going to have twos on the diagonal, and that's not going to work. So there may be something stronger than this can be said that I don't know what it is. Okay, so let's look a little bit at computation. The first fast algorithms, polynomial time for doing this, was in 1979 by Rowdy Kanan and Bakum, and they didn't actually compute the complexity, but I think it was somewhere around n to the 7th or n to the 8th. Got it down to n to the 4th, and actually that was n to the omega, omega plus 1, so the cost of matrix multiplication plus 1. And that was randomized, so you're allowed to make random choices. And then R doesn't like randomization, and he got it down to n to the omega plus 1. So that's connected to matrix multiplication. So around this time, we were starting to look at sparsity, and so I looked at this and got it down another factor of n. This is for a matrix which has mu non-zero entries. So if you think of mu as being n out of n squared, then this is a cubic algorithm instead of a quartic algorithm. So that's good. And then in a sequence of papers, we got it down even further. We got it down to n to the 2.66. And that one even came with an implementation. So, and that's not using any fast matrix multiplication at all.
So this is also
Krylov-type. This is another,
This is what I missed the question.
Krylov-type. Is it sort of a Krylov-type algorithm where you're only allowed to do matrix vector products? So this one is, and I won't go into it here, though I'll actually touch on a few of the ideas in what's to come. I actually don't believe that's the final answer. I mean, I think there are, certainly n to the 2.5 should be doable here. That was 10 years ago. So it's been stalled in a few ways. Okay, I want to talk a little bit. So working over the integers can be a little bit painful for a number of reasons. First of all, they can get big. And second of all, a lot of what goes on in computing Smith forms is better thought about p-adically. And what I mean by p-adically is when I represent when I expand numbers mod about a prime. And so I'll start with something easier. I'll say z mod p to the e. So that's the number is the integer between 0 and p to the e minus 1, where I wrap around for multiplication and addition. And so the input here is an n by n matrix with mu non-zero entries. The output here is the Smith form of the matrix mod p to the e. Now, this is exactly the same as before, except now I take everything mod p to the e, and this actually has a much simpler form, which is why this is a nicer problem. And the original problem is quite closely related to this. So the Smith form of every matrix is basically has a sequence of ones, a sequence of p's, sequence of p squares, p cubed, etc., and possibly some zeros. So if you think about the example I had before, it was 1, 1, it was 1, 3, and it was 1, 9. So a 1, 3 to the power of 0, 3 to the power of 1, 3 squared. And so the example was sort of deliberate, happens to work, also work mod 3 squared, mod p to the e.
So when you say can you use the Smith form, you want just the S, you're not worried about the stuff on either side?
Right here, I'm not worried about the stuff. I mean, I'm actually interested in what sort of the distributions are of this. There are applications where one needs the transformation matrices, and there are applications when one doesn't.
If you need the transformation, does that up your count?
Does that up mean the complexity count? Not it. So if you look back here, so this one, these two algorithms actually compute the transformation matrices. You need an extra factor of n because they're actually pretty big. the entries in the transformation matrices can have about n bits each. So you immediately get n cubed as just sort of a as a lower bound on just because of the output size, if you like. So yeah, it typically gets quite a bit heavier in the computation. So this is my, so I say every matrix is equivalent to a diagonal. Let's just look at the powers of P in that diagonal, where I choose a P, and I'm magically going to be given that P. So here's a subproblem, if you will, or another problem. Compute the Smith form of a sparse matrix over P to the E. I don't know how to do it over the integers. I'm going to give you the matrix. I'm going to give you the prime P. I'm going to give you E. And I want it to work. I want the algorithm to take that long. Now, why would I expect this? So for a sparse matrix, it turns out, so this, if you think of this matrix S mod P. If you thought of a mod P, all these guys over here would just go to zero. And the number of ones is actually the rank of the matrix mod P. And if I look at this matrix mod P squared, I have a bunch of ones and a bunch of p's, and then everything to the right is zero. So the second coefficient, this R1, can sort of be computed by a rank-like thing mod p squared. So you can sort of think of the Smith form mod p to the e as a rank, kind of a rank object. It's got a little more information than a rank. It's a sequence of things. The first one is the rank mod p, and then it gets more complicated after that. So where does this cause come from? Well, it comes from the fact that there are Krylov-like matrices, algorithms, for computing the rank of a sparse matrix. And in fact, one of them is by Eric and Dave, Eric Kopen and David Saunders in the early 90s. The original work on this, again, was the person who introduced these Krylov-like algorithms to discrete domains, Douglas Wiedemann, in the mid-80s. Okay. So Smith in 1861 gave an algorithm. It was the very naive, in retrospect, algorithm that I described earlier. You know, eliminate the first column, eliminate the first row, et cetera, et cetera. He also showed something different. Let's let lambda k be the GCD of all k by k minors. So that means the GCD of the determinants of all k by k submatrices of the matrix. So one by one submatrices, that's just the GCD of all entries of the matrix. Two by two submatrices, that's the GCD of all size two submatrices. Choose two rows, choose two columns, take the determinant of that. Choose two more rows, take two more columns, take the determinant of that. You do that for every possible one, exponential number. And that you call that lambda 2, lambda 3, etc., where lambda n is actually the determinant of the matrix.
That's actually a delta.
Sorry, I said lambda s. Thank you. Did I do that last time I gave this talk to you? Anyway, delta. Thank you. I know that's a delta. If it didn't have that little bar in the bottom, it would be a lambda. Anyway, then Smith showed that, in fact, this was the Smith, that's another version of the Smith form. Now, this gives a terrible algorithm. Right? But because there's a GCD, you're taking the GCD of an exponential number of determinants. It also gives one of the great titles of an algorithm called Mr. Smith Goes to Las Vegas. And Eric was a part of this.
It's not my title, I said.
It's not his title. Okay, fine, it's not his title. It's Cal Dolphin, Krishni, Amurdi, and Saunders, and as Saunders gave the title, it's a great title, but the observation is actually very cool. Because the observation is, okay, there's an exponential number of these minors. What you do is you randomize, you take your original matrix and you multiply it by a random unimodular matrix. So a matrix with plus or minus one is a determinant. That doesn't change the Smith form at all. It shouldn't change anything. But then, all you have to do is take the GCD of two minors instead of an exponential number of minors. And so suddenly you have an algorithm which is actually pretty quick. It's So instead of doing two k by k, so an exponential number of k by k minors, you're doing two. And you do this all the way through, and this actually leads to, I think you were looking at, this was a parallel complexity. It was the 80s, right? So people were looking at NC. So a parallel complexity class. But I was going to say we don't see much anymore, but actually we now see again. It's having a bit of a renaissance. But it's a great algorithm in a number of ways. The other thing I want to observe about this is you can sort of see why the random Smith form actually is all ones. Because if you take the GCD of a bunch of numbers, and the numbers are random, what do you expect the GCD to be? One. So that first one, you expect to be one. So now you take the GCD of all the 2x2 submatrices, of the determinants of a bunch of 2x2 submatrices. You know, so you take a 2x2 submatrix, you take a 2x2 submatrix, you do this a few times, you take the GCD, and you get 1. So you get 1 over 1. Okay, so it's 1. And you keep on doing this. You say, okay, well, eventually they're all going to be 1s, and then at the end I'm left with the determinant. Well, that's not 1. So that's sort of the intuition. Why doesn't this work as an analysis? What goes wrong? Well, what goes wrong is if you look at all the n minus 1 by n minus 1 minors, they all overlap each other. And they have some amount of, there's no independence in the random sampling. And so the proof becomes very hard. You know, you got to introduce a whole bunch more variables, but there's no independence. So that's the problem there. Okay, so, but we use this for average case analysis, we use this for a whole bunch of other things that we've been using it for, ORI polynomials. See, these algorithms actually have had some renaissance again. Okay, so now comes to sort of the meat of the... So I've spent a chunk of my career looking at computing Jordan forms and solving systems of sparse matrices over the reals. I spent another chunk doing elimination algorithms and computing Smith forms of matrices over the integers. And I always thought of these as fairly distinct exercises. And of course, if you look at our original matrix, we computed the eigenvalues, we computed the Jordan form, and we got that. And we compute, and these were, of course, that, it's a similarity transform, so that and that are the inverse of each other. Oops. And then we did the Smith form, and we have a unimodular matrix. That unimodular matrix is not the inverse of that, but you get something where 1 divides 3 divides 9. And the question is there any connection between the eigenvalues and the invariant factors? And so that's what I want to look at for the rest of the talk. So I'm going to say a little bit about p-adic valuations first. And what this is an attempt to put an absolute value basically by the number of times p divides a number. So it's the maximum, the p-adic valuation of an integer is the maximum I such that p to the I divides the number. So think of 9, 3-adic valuation is 2. This behaves somewhat like a net regular absolute value. It's a non-Archimedean valuation, fancy language. You can extend it to the rationals, A divided by B, just by taking the difference between the valuation of A and the valuation of B. And you can also extend it to, well, I'll extend it only to algebraic integers here. What I mean by that is roots of monic polynomials, integer polynomials. And the definition doesn't really matter, but if you take the minimal polynomial of an algebraic integer, and you take the p-adic valuation of the constant coefficient, and you divide it by the degree of the polynomial, that gives you a nice p-adic valuation, or a thick absolute value that works for algebraic integers. I mean, you can take this up to the reals and the complexes. It doesn't really matter. The point here is that the eigenvalues of our original matrix A are algebraic integers. And so we have a way of talking about the matrix now over an integer matrix over the PS for any particular prime P. So threes. Okay, how does that help us? Suppose the Smith form A, so now here's the connection. Suppose the Smith form A looks like this, S1 through Sn. And then I give you a prime, P, 3. And so the Smith form has a sorting. It basically S1 divides S2 divides S3, et cetera, et cetera. So that means the p-adic valuation of S1 is less than the p-adic valuation of S2, is less than the p-adic valuation of S3, et cetera. So these guys are, they're sorted. They're sorted by divisibility, and therefore they're sorted by p-adic valuation. Now let's look at the Jordan form. Jordan form, we'll assume because most of the time the Jordan form is trivial, let's just assume the Jordan form is trivial, it's just the eigenvalues down the diagonal. And Jordan form is usually not sorted, but I'm gonna take, and but these are algebraic integers, remember? So they have a p-adic valuation. And I'm gonna sort the eigenvalues by that p-adic valuation because I can choose any order I want, I'm choosing one. The question is, how often does the p-adic valuation in the Smith form equal the p-adic valuation in the Jordan form? Remember I showed you 1, 3, and 9, and then I sent showed you a bunch of real eigenvalues. Suddenly when you look at it in p-adic valuation, the question then becomes, well, how often are they equal? Because certainly 1, 3, and 9 were not equal to the previous values, and the answer is almost always. For a randomly chosen matrix, the invariant factors and the eigenvalues are the same when you look at them p-adic values.
So almost always over prime p?
For any fixed prime p, and I will say what almost always means. You know, very precise.
Does the fact that the product of the SIs equals the product of the lambda i's play a role?
Yeah, so I mean that, so the one thing you can observe from the beginning, there's one sort of clearly observable fact, is that the determinants do match up. So that's sort of that's the one obvious connection between them. And there were sort of, prior to this work, there were sort of, there was work by Morris Newman in particular in the lattice community, who there's a slightly stronger thing you can say there. But really, before we went in, we sort of scoured the literature, you don't get that much beyond that. Yes?
Could you go back to the definition of the p-adic?
Yeah.
So that depends only on the constant coefficient of like the minimal polynomial.
Of the minimal polynomial of,
Wouldn't the minimal polynomial of the eigenvalues, wouldn't you expect that to be the same for each of the eigenvalues?
The minimal polynomial
of the for each eigenvalue, the minimal polynomial.
It's not even
the
difference between the
minimal.
Yeah, it could be.
Or sort of, randomly, I expect it.
Yeah,
she says it's an irreducible polynomial.
It's irreducible over the integers, but it's not necessarily, in general it might not be, right?
Like the example you gave, the one...
In the example I gave, it's going to be the case, yes.
But then wouldn't they all have the same p-adic valuation? Because the constant...
No, because... this is a factorized. It also works over any extension of this as well. So I have to think about that. So I'll, okay. So anyway, I'll think about that. But
this is the case where you get all ones.
Yeah, this is the case where you get all ones. It works for. I'll give it for that case, and I'll describe it more generally because you can fix the. So anyway.
So the case you're giving is the non-generic case, basically.
Yeah, the non-generic case is more interesting, I guess, is the situation here. So anyway, so in the Jordan forms. We look at the matrix A here. We consider, here's the example. You consider the three adic numbers here. You have 0, 1, and 2 as our eigenvalues. You have 0, 1, and 2 as, so we look at the p-adic expansion. And you're right, this is going to be an irreducible polynomial over the order fractions. But I'll leave that in a second. Okay, so why does this work? And
could you go back to the previous slide once?
Okay, so let me actually, I'll spend more time on this. Sorry, I'm still thinking in the background. Okay, so we have our matrix A, we have our eigenvalues, we have our characteristic, we have our toroidal divisors. We consider the three adic numbers here. We consider these eigenvalues as three adic numbers. And we have 0, 1, and 2. Basically, because 3 to the 0, 3 to the 1, 3 squared. And now we have we look at out lambda 1, lambda 2, lambda 3, which are the eigenvalues. And I treat these as three adic numbers, algebraic integers. And surprisingly, to me at least, p adic value, I expand these out. I force Sage, I think, to expand these out. And the first, you notice the first number here is minus 1, which is not divisible by 3. The second number is 3. The third number is 3 squared. And we have 3 dividing this 0 times, 1 time, and 2 times. Yes?
I don't see how this definition of finding the periodic variation of these lambdas is the same as what you gave before.
This is for rational numbers.
Yeah.
It's a different one for algebraic numbers.
So this just happened. It's a small example. Yeah, so in general you wouldn't get this, but I mean the definition still works. I mean, this is where the toy example part comes.
So
the
generic case is algebraic, and that's why you get
all the ones. Right, exactly. Okay, so where is this coming from? So why would the terminal divisors and the eigenvalues start to look the same? Well, I mean, you could look at the, we'll do a little bit of definition. So this is just notation that a minor is selected by a set of rows and a set of columns, and we can compute the determinant. The characteristic polynomial, if you look at the coefficients of the characteristic polynomial, it's in fact the sum of symmetric minors. Oops, wrong button. So it's a sum of symmetric minors here. So it's the where I look at all symmetric minors, for the all symmetric minors of size k, and I add them up. And so then this immediately gets you that since lambda k is the GCD of all k by k minors, then lambda k divides fk. And it also immediately gets that the p adic valuation of lambda k is less than the p adic valuation of fk. So that's an easy fact, because in fact, so the lambda k of course is a GCD of all of them, therefore it must divide each one of these, therefore it's less than or equal to. So that's not a particular surprise, and that's something that, I mean, it's not a particular surprise in retrospect, but it sort of says that the determinant of divisors are hiding in the coefficients of the characteristic polynomial. And the fact this works theoretically is not particularly surprising. The interesting thing is the question of whether or not this less than or equal to is an equal to. So algorithmically, this is going to matter, because less than or equal to is not that strong. So we prove that, in fact, most of the time, and we prove that in a stronger sense, not just for the generic case, that in fact that most of the time, the p-adic valuation of lambda k is equal to the p-adic valuation of fk, the kth coefficient. And so we say in this case that the a is p-characterized, so it's characterized by the characteristic polynomial. And what we want to prove then, so we have to prove this, of course, and then we want to prove that p characterized implies p correspondent. And I don't think I said it, but p correspondent means that the p adic valuations of the eigenvalues equals to the p adic valuations of the invariant factors. So I should have said at the beginning, this work is all from a paper last year, a year and a half ago, in linear algebra and its applications, with my grad student, Mustafa El-Sheikh. So most matrices are p-characterized, i.e. that this is equal to this most of the time. Is actually pretty boring, so I'll leave it out. Again, it's one of these Schwarz simple type algorithms. You just show that this fact is equivalent to a polynomial system being non-zero, and then eventually it's, you just grind it out. The more interesting case is when p-characterized actually implies p-correspondent. And for this, we actually use Newton polygons in, I think, a nice way. So what we do is we start with your characteristic polynomial. You look at the points in the plane that look like 0, 0, and then 1 and the p-adic valuation of f1, 2 and the p-adic valuation of f2, up to n and the p-adic valuation of fn, and you draw a convex hull of these points. So you basically draw a hull around this, these points. I'll give you a pretty picture in the next slide. And there's a lovely theorem of Ostrowski in 1934, which says that if you have this convex hull defined by a set of points, and the slopes are m1 through ms, and the lengths are l1 through ls, then the polynomial has lj roots with p-adic valuation mj. So let me show you a picture of that. So there's our matrix. There's our characteristic polynomial. You look at the p-adic valuations of the coefficients, 3 to the 0, 3 to the 1, and 3 cubed. You plot these numbers, 0, 0, 1, and 3. And the slopes give you the eigenvalues, and the lengths give you the slopes give you the number, the value, the slopes give you the valuation, and the lengths give you the number of eigenvalues. So in this case, the lengths are all 1, and the slopes are 0, 1, and 2.
And how is the proof for that?
Ostrowski's proof? It's not that hard, as I recall. If there's a fair amount of infrastructure built up, and then and this is easy to say in retrospect.
It's more or less the same proof as when you desingularize a curve.
It's the same proof done p-adically. Yeah, yeah. I don't know what the relative timing of those two things were. But
One was probably Newton.
that's fair enough. Okay.
What is the length here? The length as well.
Length here is x-axis length.
Oh, okay. What is
f0, 1, f2, f0? F0. These are the coefficients of the characteristic polynomial. So we're looking at the p-adic valuations of the coefficients of characteristic and plotting them as valuations. You have a question?
The length should be the lattice length?
The length should be is the lattice length, yeah. So here it's 0, 1, and 2. So this is the easy version, is the sense that most matrices are p-characterized, we're done. You know, most matrices are generic, so it's not that interesting. And I guess the real question here is to say what happens if, and remember, the motivation here is to find an algorithmic mechanism to take fast algorithms for finding eigenvalues and turn it into fast algorithms for finding Smith forms of sparse matrices. We don't really care about Smith forms of trivial sparse, of trivial. When the Smith form is trivial, that's actually not that interesting a case. In fact, usually you can figure that out by other mechanisms. And so really the meat, if you like, is to prove that this works with any fixed Smith form. So what you do is you fix a matrix size n. Here's a statement of the theorem. You choose an epsilon, or you're given an epsilon. You have a prime key, which you choose to be sufficiently large. or away, which has to be sufficiently large to make this work. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to say, okay, let's fix a shape for the Smith form, E1 to EN. That means it's going to, the Smith form is P to the E1, P to the E2, P to the E3, etc., to P to the EN. And the question now becomes is, how many of the matrix, the random matrices that have that Smith form have this property that the eigenvalues correspond to the Smith form? You know, the p-adic valuations, the eigenvalues correspond to the p-adic valuations of the invariant factors. And that's sort of the interesting question here. And I'm not going to be, the proximate technique goes forward, but there's a lot more detail here. And knowing that would allow us to, if we could compute the eigenvalues, we can then compute the Smith form. And so what we're able to show is that for epsilon, for if the set of matrices G, this is a set of all matrices, n by n matrices, which have a particular fixed Smith form, and you look at the ones which are P correspond, you know, you look at the ones which are, what is the percentage of those, or the number of those which are P correspondent, it's basically 1 minus epsilon times the total number. So almost all, I mean almost all in a fairly strong sense. And it's funny, so I should say the this actually started out as a computational exercise, not as a mathematical exercise. We initially submitted it to linear algebra's applications as a computational exercise, and we submitted it in the language of preconditioners, not in the language of counting. So we started out by saying, okay, so you have a matrix A that you want to compute the Smith form of. So now you randomize it. You randomize it by multiplying it by a unimodular matrix. And in fact, the unimodular matrices we used are the ones from Eric and Dave's paper in 1991, these sort of tuplets, algebraic tuplets matrices, or circulant matrices. And then we showed, after randomization, the probability that that we could now compute a Jordan form or a minimal polynomial and extract the Smith form from it. So that was sort of the original mode of operation here. And LAA didn't like that. They wanted to see it as a counting argument. And so we ripped almost all the computation out of it. And now, but we're still actually working on the how to, you know, which is a good thing because we actually, in the end, I'll show you there aren't that, that the computational results aren't complete yet. But that was the motivation, is to take any matrix, particularly one you care about, and transform it into a random matrix of which you compute the eigenvalues, and from that you can extract the Smith form. So that's our goal here, yes.
So there's this word most that keeps floating around.
Yes.
There's lots of classes of problems where the generic matrix from that class will have certain submatrices that are predetermined form, maybe blocks of zeros, identity blocks, et cetera, et cetera. You don't have to give me one today, but are there versions of this for the structure case also?
So, I mean, it depends. So structure in all these Lanczos algorithms is sort of captured by this fast flat box. So everything in the algorithms will, that, I mean, I'll say a little bit about, actually I don't even know if they do. A structured matrix is not a structured matrix in, as one that you can actually look inside it and see the structure. In a certain sense, we're not looking inside at all. We're working like one does in conjugate gradient or Lanczos algorithms, where it's strictly a matrix vector product. And so if there are big zeros in that matrix, large numbers of zeros, that matrix vector product is fast.
On the other hand, it could alter things like your assumptions about the eigenvalues.
Yeah, but in some sense, the proof is not, it says it doesn't, right? Because when I say it is probably here, it means on every input for a random, let me get the quantifiers right. On any input, if I choose a random, for a random choice of a preconditioner, there is a certain probability that I will get it correct. And so, and that probability is greater than zero. So in a sense, any matrix can be transformed into one which is p-correspondent. So you're never in a case where something is, there are no bad matrices for which there's not a high probability way of predicting.
You're assuming then something about the distribution of your randomness. That's the only thing.
When I talk about the I'm talking, so the preconditioners are chosen with in a particular way, but they assume they work with no assumptions on the matrix itself.
So by random, you mean what then? So you draw on
it depends where. So in random, in the algorithms, it's always analyzed with respect to, you choose from a, if you're working within a finite field, you choose from a set of size, of some prescribed size, and you actually get a very hard-edged probability bound of the probability of success.
And uniform?
It's always uniform, yes. So, I mean, typically these are algorithms over finite fields. We're taking integer matrices, we're working over finite fields, and we're saying the preconditioners we're using are choosing coefficients in these preconditioner matrices which are randomly and uniformly chosen either over the whole field or over a prescribed subset of the field.
But the entry itself is just an integer value, but there's no finite value assumption on it.
No, so I mean the entry, so where the problem, I mean it's actually skip forward to the, the problem that I was talking about there is Z mod, where I give you the integer matrix, I give you the prime. So I'm saying, what is the Smith form mod P to the E? Okay, let me finish up. This is my last slide. And I will end with an open problem to show you that we actually were not successful in some of this. So we now have this way of moving from Smith forms to computing eigenvalues. We have more knowledge about computing eigenvalues. But in fact, we can't even do this mod p squared. So here's a question for the audience. Your input is an n by n matrix with mu non-zero entries, where you think of mu as n. It's mod 9, so you know the Smith form looks like 1s and 3s. And the question is, can you come up with an algorithm that finds the number of 3s? Finding the number of 1s is easy, that's the rank mod 3. Fast algorithm for that. How do you find the number of 3s versus the number of 0s? And the answer is, I don't know. And so far as I know, no one of the other authors that I listed on the slides had any idea as well. And you can choose your favorite prime for now. So everything is discrete, everything is, there's no coefficient growth, there's no issues of random sampling, it's all very easy, and yet somehow it's not. With that, thank you.
Thank you very much, Mark. We asked you a lot of questions already. Are there any more questions?
I have a quick question about the Newton method you use. Why are the slopes integers?
Why are the slopes integers?
I think it's because base is unit.
Yeah, why would this? Well, I guess you know that the p-adic value, I mean, I guess in general they're probably not, and if they're not, then you know that your matrix isn't p-correspondent, because you know that the Smith form, they are, we know that most matrices are, the p-adic valuations correspond to the Smith form entries, and so when they're not, then you know you're in one of these cases where it doesn't, they're not.
So generic.
Generically they are, and in practice they're not, think is the,
I see.
But the slopes are limited because simply you're going by one.
The length is not necessarily,
you're taking a convex hull.
If the convex hull is somehow wrong and doesn't describe an actual Smith form, you can get fractions in that.
Yeah. Right.
In fact, the examples where this breaks, in fact, will be fractions with something that done on it.
Well, thank you again, Mark.
Yeah.